Well, good morning, church. Good morning. Happy New Year. If this is your first time back to church, that's all right. You can put your hands together if you're excited to be here today. I'm really pumped about this series. I believe that God's going to do a great and awesome work in it and through it. But before we dive into the message today, I do want to mention and get everybody on board on the same page with what we're doing this year. In years past, we've done a corporate fast together, sometimes different days, different lengths. And I really feel like it's been laid on my heart this year to do a corporate fast again. We've done it in different years, different ways every time. But this year we want to do a Daniel fast again. And for some of you who know what that is no, basically roughly no meats, sweets, or pop. Now, if you're sitting here thinking, what is a fast, number one? What is this all about? Is this getting cultish? They're asking me not to eat certain foods. This is a total biblical thing, and we don't talk about it actually enough, I don't believe, in our walk, in our relationship with Christ. But every year, I think it's good to start off on the right foot and start off giving God all of our focus and all of our attention. So first and foremost, I want you to know that a fast is not a diet, and it's not just you're abstaining from food to get a certain result physically, but it is to get results spiritually. And when we deny ourselves what we want, and if you're anything like me, when you say that no meats, you start, you know, cringing in fear and getting worrisome about it, because I could eat meat all day, every day. You start to think, what am I going to do? Well, I'm going to seek God, I'm going to pray. And so a biblical fast is abstaining from food of some kind for a certain period of time. Some fasts are just one day. People can fast one day. People can fast a half a day. People can fast a week. Sometimes people do complete fast. If you look in the Bible, Jesus did a complete fast for 40 days and 40 nights, which is pretty serious. I've done a few complete fasts just for a couple days and thought I wanted to die. But if you're used to fasting or you've done it before, you know what to expect. If you haven't, listen, I didn't want to take a ton of time talking about today, or sometimes I've done a series. On the website, now not on the app, because the app we've had some issues, but on the website, if you go to the website, on the home page, you will find a little link that you can click on that talks all about the fast. It's something I've wrote up that you can look at to explain a little bit more about what fasting is, about what fasting isn't. I do want to make mention, and it says there on that link as well, that this is not a guilt trip at all. If you can't do it for certain reasons, health, don't do it. But also, if you can do a portion of it, do that. Allow God to speak to you with what to fast, how to fast. And with fasting, also, I encourage people, because it is more about your time than what you're eating or not eating, spend time with God. Spend time with God in prayer. Spend time in His Word. Anytime you go and you start to grab something you normally would, what happens is you remember, oh, we're fasting, so I think I'll just pray. It reminds us often when we go to grab something. You know, I don't want certain things often. I'm not a sweets guy. I don't eat a lot of sweets when it comes to, you know, chocolate. I don't just crave chocolate. Now, a steak, absolutely, all day, every day. But it's so funny, when I'm fasting, I want sweets more. You know, like I want chocolate chip cookies, and I want a Snickers bar, and I want Hershey Kisses, and I want Reese's Cups. It's like, I don't really get in that. It's just funny how our minds begin to work in that way. Now, a Daniel fast, if you look at really what a Daniel fast was, they focused heavily on just vegetables. Vegetables and some fruits, I believe. But this is a modified version, if you will, when I say no meats, sweets, or pop. If you want to take it a step further and do other things, if you want to do, you know, no breads or, you know, no dairy or something like that, do what you really feel like you need to. But once again, remember this. This is not a diet, and this is not something you're doing just for physical things. This is a spiritual thing. Fasting is a spiritual thing. And once again, that link has all kind of information. If you're still like, I've never heard of fasting, I give you plenty of scripture on there on referencing what fasting is, what it isn't. So I just want to encourage you guys to come together as a church. I believe God's going to do great and awesome things this year like never before in our church. And we're going to run this fast from January 11th to January 31st. It's a 21-day fast, a three-week fast. And so that's going to kick off this Wednesday, I believe, is the 11th, if you want to start that fast with us. Like I said, and throughout time, if you're still learning about it and thinking about it, and you decide you want to jump in on it on the 15th or the 16th, just jump in. I don't want to put a bunch of rules and regulations on fasting, okay, guys? So read it, go to the link, check it out, and then we'll do this journey and this fast together. If you've never done it before, just out of curiosity, how many have fasted before? Listen, this is not a, yeah, okay, good. A lot of people have. If you haven't, listen, just try it. Try, and I'm going to tell you right now, if you spend time in God's word, and you spend time in prayer, and you ask God, show me what you want me to see on this fast, God will begin to speak to you like never before. I'm guaranteeing you right now, that's not my guarantee, it's God's guarantee, it's God's word. So what I like to do too for a fast is set up a few like bullet points of what I'm really praying for, of what I'm seeking God for. So this year it's, you know, 4 or 5 things for me that I'm, you know, personally and also for the church that I want to see happen in my life and in the life of the church. And so I'm believing for those things in a great way. I'm believing for breakthrough in a great way. So do a new thing, start a new thing this year, and let's fast together, corporate fast. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, let's pray, and we're going to jump right into Soul Detox, the heavy soul. Father, we thank you, and we praise you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for your presence that's here in this place. I pray, Lord God, today that you would anoint your servant as he speaks your word. May he speak nothing more, nothing less, only what you would have him to speak in this place. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We're going to start out in Matthew chapter 11, verse 21, Matthew 11, verse 28. Then Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. We must remember that we are not a body with a soul, but we are a soul with a body. We are not a body with a soul, but we are a soul with a body. Now, recent studies have shown this, that this generation deals with depression more than ever before. A low-grade depression where nothing is horribly wrong, just nothing is right. And yet we have more now than ever before. We have more things. We have more resources. We have more material possession. No one can deny this, especially in the country in which we live. So it's obvious that those things are not the key to unlocking happiness. Things are not the key. We can see this because if there's more depression than ever before, obviously we're missing something. And it's not material things. It's not possession. It's not money. Psalm 42, verse 5 says this. David said, why am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I put my trust in God. I'll praise him again. David asked himself a question. He said, why am I discouraged? Why am I sad? And I think sometimes we need to ask ourselves questions. I ask myself questions all the time. Why do I feel this way, God? Because there's always a reason behind the way we feel what we feel. Well, the question I want to look at today is why are our souls so heavy? Today I want to deal with our past, our present, and our future. Our past, our present, and our future. Why are our souls so heavy? Now, the first point is this. They're heavy with hurts from the past. Heavy with hurts from the past. If I was to ask for a show of hands today, how many of you have hurts from the past? I would guarantee most everybody would say, yeah, I have some hurts from the past. There have been things in my life that I've had to deal with, that I've had to overcome, and some of you are still dealing with those hurts from the past, even today, maybe from years ago, they haven't been dealt with in your life. I'll say it like this. Many people deal with a present heaviness from past hurts. Many people deal with a present heaviness from past hurts. Lamentations chapter 3, verses 19 through 20 says, the thought of my suffering and homelessness is bitter beyond words. I will not forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Jeremiah, in this passage, he's reflecting on some painful memories. Now, I want to say there's nothing wrong with reflection as long as it gives you some redirection. Reflection is a good thing. I believe reflection is a God thing. But oftentimes people will reflect and allow those things to bring pain again instead of purpose. people will reflect and not allow that reflection to give them a redirection in their life. Why are our souls so heavy? I think the second reason is this. They're heavy with the troubles in the present. Heavy with troubles in the present. Maybe you came in today and you have something you're dealing with right now in your life that you're heavy about. You ever dealt with something and you just couldn't wait to get it over with? You know? Maybe you knew you had to have some kind of confrontation ahead, some conversation that you think will turn to confrontation. And you're dealing with that, you're wrestling with that, you're thinking, man, I don't want to do this. That's a heaviness with trouble in the present. I've dealt with that at times in my life, knowing that something is coming ahead and knowing that, man, I have to deal with this issue. Maybe someone said something or done something to you. Maybe a situation in your life has happened recently, and man, you're dealing with a present heaviness. You're heavy with the trouble in the present. Job chapter 4, verse 5, it says, but now when troubles strike, you lose heart. You're terrified when it touches you. Now. A lot of times there is now trouble in our life. The now distracts us and it discourages us from moving forward. Many people are paralyzed in the now. Paralyzed by what they see. They can't move past it because they're discouraged by it. They're hurt by it. And so they are stuck in this present. Many feel stuck right now where they are. They feel like they'll never get out. You know, something about the circumstances that surround us almost make us feel trapped. Sometimes when people look out in the now and in the present, that they can only see what's around them. And so they feel stuck in their current situation. Many people live like this. The third heaviness I want to talk about today is heaviness with anxiety about the future. Heaviness with anxiety about the future. Mark chapter 14, verses 33 to 34 says, he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he became deeply troubled and distressed. He told them, my soul is crushed. Remember, this is Jesus himself. He said, my soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. He said, I'm deeply troubled and distressed. Now, for me personally, I deal with the future more than the past and the present, but we're all different. Each one of us deal with the past more or the present more or the future. You can pick and choose what it is that you deal with most. Maybe it's things you've had to go through. Maybe it's something you're going through right now. Or maybe you're even terrified about what is ahead. You're thinking things like this. How are we going to do this? I'm afraid it can't be done. I'm overwhelmed with problems. I don't see how this is going to work out in the future. Some maybe even feel that everywhere you turn, there's something weighing you down. Do not fall into the trap of thinking that's just the way it is. Don't fall into that trap. There's a trap that will say, well, that's just how it is. That's just what it's going to be. There's nothing you can do about it. That's just the way that it is. There's a famous song even with that chorus tagline, right? And I'm going to refrain from singing it. As much as I want to, it's deep within me, but I will not. That's just the way it is. The truth of the matter is, that's not the way that it has to be. We accept too much weight. Weight that is not God's plan or desire from our lives. We don't have to live with a heavy soul. And I can say that with certainty because it is not God's plan in His Word for us to live with a heavy soul. He came, He sent His Son Jesus to give us freedom. To give us life. Amen. He came to set us free from a heavy soul. Psalm 42, verses 5 through 6 goes on to say, why am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad? I put my hope in God. I will praise Him again. My Savior, my God. And he goes back again. He says, now I'm deeply discouraged, but I will remember you. Have you ever felt like that in your life? I'm going to put my hope in God. I'm deeply discouraged. Amen. Anybody with me today? You leave church, you say, oh, I'm so excited. And another song comes to my head. It's like it's a blessing and a curse at the same time. It's the only thing in my life I can ever remember is lyrics to songs I've heard 10 years ago. It's crazy. We leave the service and we say, I'm just so excited about what God is doing in my life. I'm so happy I'm here today. I have hope. I have joy. And then we leave, and a few hours later, we can say, I'm so discouraged. Maybe we read something on social media, or we see a post, or someone calls us and gives us news. We were so excited one moment, and we're so discouraged the next. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Or maybe you pray and you say, God, this is going to be different. This year is going to be different. And maybe you're hearing about the fast. You're like, okay, this is it. And this is going to happen to some of you, and I want you to remember, I want you to log this in your memory, because you're going to get started on this fast, and it's going to be like, wow. While spending time with God is good, I feel like I hear him more clearly. I feel like his word's speaking to me as I'm denying myself. And then you're going to get a few days into it, and you're going to feel like you just hit a wall that smacked you in the face, and you don't know if you can move forward. Those of you who have fasted before, you know what I'm talking about. It's like, wow, God was showed up, and I felt close to God. Now I just feel so disconnected. I'm just going through the motions. It's easy to happen. You become discouraged one moment, and you put your hope in God the next. But we need to talk. We need to talk about how to move past this heavy soul, how to move past it, how to get past our past, our present, and our future circumstances. I'll start by saying this. You need to tell your soul, remember God's faithfulness in the past. Remember God's faithfulness in the past. If you look throughout history, and specifically Israel, the back and forth with God, we love you, God. We are turning from you. You've set us free. Now we're going back to our old ways. And isn't that humanity? I've been in church long enough to see people come and see them go, to see them on and see them off. I see them come in excited. I see them leave discouraged. We have to remember something, that this is life, that we will deal with hurt and we will deal with triumph. We will deal with pain, but we will deal with victory. And one thing that's going to move us past a heavy soul and from living there in a state of heaviness is remember that God is faithful in the past. Remember what he's done in your life. Lamentation 3:19-23, the extended version of these scripture that we've already read, it says, the thought of my suffering and homelessness is bitter beyond words. I will never forget this awful time as I grieve over my loss. Yet, I still dare to hope when I remember this. You see, there's a shift here in scripture. We got to look for those shifts in scripture. It's like, oh, okay, the attitude begins to change. The heart begins to change. He says, the faithful love of the Lord never ends. His mercies never cease. Great is his faithfulness, and his mercies begin afresh each morning. And now, I love a new day. I love what it represents, but I really love a new year. I really do. Some people look at it differently. It's just another day. I don't think that. I think it's a great time to reset, to reboot, and to forget at that moment yesterday and move on to the things that are ahead. Now, like I said earlier, reflection is good as long as it redirects you. Reflection is good as long as it redirects you. If you don't have a good past, you need to let God give you a new one. If you don't have a good past, you need to let God give you a new one. You say, well, God can't do that. Well, what does it mean when he washes you white as snow? See, he casts all of our sin into the deepest ocean where our sin has separated us as far as from the east is from the west. If you know what the difference is from the east to the west, it's continual. There's no end to it. There's no start or stop. It means we are made new. God can give us a new past, set us on the course for a new future. If you don't have a good past, let God give you a new one. We must call to our minds God's faithfulness. For me personally, I have to recall the moment that he touched my heart to draw near to him for salvation. I'll never forget it. I'll never forget that day. I'll never forget the feeling. I'll never forget that moment. It wasn't lightning bolts all around, the sky splitting, but there was just something about it. I knew God was with me. And I knew that the gospel message was for me. You see, sometimes in life we want to make things so miraculous, like it was so amazing and it was so magnificent. The truth is, it was just an ordinary day. It was normal, but I had realized what God wanted to do in my life. And so that's what made it great for me. I remember the day God called me to salvation. I remember when he called me into the ministry, and I had no idea what that really even meant. I remember the day that we launched out in faith and said, yes, we're going to build this church. I remember the day when sticks were going up, and I can remember standing off at a distance and watching these two-by-fours and two-by-sixes be erected, and I thought to myself, oh my gosh, this is happening. I remember that. It was a great day. It was a monumental day for me, but it was a terrifying day as well. But then I remember as well, I called in my mind the first service we ever had as this church started. I can remember being terrified, is anybody going to show up? And then 127 people showed up for the first service. Now, come to find out later, they all just showed up because they were afraid that no one was going to show up, so they just came to support me for the first service, because we dropped about 50% the next week. But I'm thankful. I'm really thankful they showed up. It was a great day. But then I remember the steps we've taken throughout time, and I'm just talking about the big things with this church. This is not counting the personal steps in my life. But I can remember when we stood before the church and said, we're going to go to Wahama, and there was the delayed cheer. Like, yeah, this is going to be good. And then we grew like never before at Wahama. And I can remember when we took the step to build this facility. And I can remember the first service when we were over capacity for the first service. I thought, well, okay, God's faithful. God is good. Good issues, right? I can recall these things, and I can see, God, you've been faithful. You've been faithful. But see, the things that we don't celebrate as much is that there's times in our life when we have to recall things like, God, I remember when I was down and I opened your word and you gave me one more word to encourage me for that day. God, I remember that time when I was really discouraged and I couldn't even pray for myself, but someone called me and just spoke something very simple to my life and it stirred me and encouraged me. God, I remember that time in year three when I thought this is just the worst year of ministry ever. And I can remember talking to someone and it encouraged me, saying, you know what, we can go on. We can move forward. We can see this thing happen. I can remember when I just really needed something. Maybe no one even knew. And then God spoke to me in my spirit. See, those are the things that we tend to forget about. We want to focus on the monumental things and those magnificent things and all the stuff everybody sees. But what I like to reflect on is the times that no one even knows about, but God is faithful in those times. He's faithful when no one's around. He's faithful when everybody thinks everything's cool, but it's not. And he speaks to us if we allow him. Remember God's faithfulness in the past. You need to tell your soul to cry out to God in the present. Cry out to God in the present. Psalm 142, verses 1 through 6 says, I cry out to the Lord. I plead for the Lord's mercy. I pour out my complaints before him, and I tell him my troubles. When I am overwhelmed, you alone know the way I should turn. Wherever I go, my enemies have set traps for me. I look for someone to come or to help me, but no one gives me a passing thought. No one will help me. No one cares a bit about what happens to me. David's really throwing himself one right now. He says, then I pray to you, O God. I say, you are my place of refuge. Here's the thing. Don't stop on verse 4. Many of you will stop on verse 4 saying things like, no one cares a bit what happens to me. No one's here to help me. But David goes on In verse 5, and he says, I pray to you, O Lord, and I say, you are my refuge. You are all I really want in life. Hear my cry, for I am very low. Rescue me from my persecutors, for they are too strong for me. We need to ask ourselves a question when we're dealing with heaviness, and it is this. Do we just want people to hear us, or do we really want God to rescue us? Because there's a big difference. Some people just want people to hear them, to hear complaints. But God is not concerned with that. God is concerned with your rescue. He's concerned with your restoration. Now, some of you might say, oh, wow, that hurts a little bit. It should. It's good to hurt sometimes. It's good to hear God's word and for it to pierce your soul, because only God's word can pierce your soul and bring healing with it. Only God's word can pierce your soul, but when it comes out, it brings a healing power to it. So do we just want people to hear us, or do we really want God to rescue us? Because there's a monumental difference. We live in a day and age where everybody's crying out, and we have all kind of avenues now to cry out. We can cry out, and the whole entire world can hear it. You know that? We can get on our phones, and just for a moment, we can cry out through any type of social media. We can put it on there for everybody to see. We're crying out, and we're letting people know. But can I tell you this? There's one that needs to know. There's a bunch of people who don't need to know, and there's one who needs to know, because there's only one who can bring restoration. There's only one who can bring healing. There's only one who can bring victory. There's only one who can bring power in your life. Do we just want to be heard, or do we want to be restored? Because there is a monumental difference between those two things. Rescue me from my persecutors, for they are too strong for me. God is our Father, and He wants us to cast all our cares on Him. 1 Peter 5:7 says, give all your worries and cares to God, for He cares about you. Isn't that encouraging that God cares about us? Even when you think the whole world doesn't, God cares about us, and He wants us to cast all our cares on Him. Third thing you need to do is tell your soul, trust in God's power for your future. Trust in God's power for your future. This is so important. This is hard because at times it goes against our reality. Some would say that Christians live in a different reality, that they don't see what really surrounds them. I choose to think of it like this. Colossians 3, 1 through 3 talks about this. It says that we need to set our mind on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on the realities of heaven. Can I tell you that there is a reality today that I see that is unseen? There is a reality today that you can tap into that is not before you, and no one else can see it for you. But you have to tap into that mindset that there is a reality far above this world. You have to choose that reality. Some people say, well, you're just out of touch. Well, you can choose to believe whatever you like. That is another fantastic quality about God, is He allows us to choose. But it's hard to trust in God's power for your future because it goes against what you see. And I am not here today to deny what people face. Because I know this world is a crazy place for many people. Life is crazy for many people. Life is turned upside down for many people. It hurts for many people, difficulties for many people. But can I tell you that God is still faithful? That if you trust God and trust His power for your future, you will overcome the current reality that you find yourself in. I want to share with you 2 Chronicles 32, verses 7 through 8. God's people and Hezekiah were facing something very difficult, facing something they didn't think that they could overcome, but He comes out with these words. He says, be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid or discouraged because of the king of Assyria or his mighty army. For there is a power far greater on our side. He may have a great army, but they are merely men. We have the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles for us. Hezekiah's words greatly encouraged the people. And it's awesome because Hezekiah's words greatly encouraged me today. He looked at his God more than the opposition in front of him. He looked at his God more than the opposition in front of him. This is what tends to happen in our life. We have a God who loves us, who saves us, who sets us free, who restores us, who heals us, but then we face opposition. I will tell you what will have the victory in your life by what you focus on. I will tell you what will rule your life when you show me what your focus is. I will tell you what will be victorious in your life when you show me what your reality is. The Bible says that we magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. That scripture is encouraging, but what sticks out to me is magnify the Lord. It doesn't say magnify the problems and God will be victorious. Magnify what you're facing and God will be victorious. The things you continue to speak will ultimately be the things that will continue to roll over you in your life. But if you continue to declare that God is good in the midst of your current reality that says everything's bad, listen, God will be victorious. God will be victorious. You have to realize that God in his power is able to keep you in the future. He's able to take you to what is ahead. Trusting God with your future is not denying what you see or face. You see, we think faith sometimes is denial. Please, don't mistake faith with denial because it's not the same. Trusting God with your future is not denying what you see or face. Some people with faith are like, well, it's not there. It's not there. If I say it enough, it's not going to be there. Guess what? Open your eyes. It's going to be there. Faith is not a denial of the things that you see, but it is believing that the God who is able will see you through the battle. It is believing that the God who is able will see you through the battle, through the difficulties, through the hurt, through the pain. It's not that you say, oh, it's not there. I'm not hurt. I'm not in pain. If you ever broke a bone, have you ever done that? I've broke several, actually one on every limb. And so every time it's kind of like you close your eyes and you say, it's not happening. Or you say other things that get your mind off of it too. And it's like, this can't be so. And then you open your eyes and you say, yeah, it still hurts. You know what I'm talking about? It still hurts. You open your eyes, it still hurts. Faith is not a denial of the things that you're facing. Faith is saying, I know a God who's able to see me through this battle. I want to encourage you today with this. God is able. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what is ahead, but God is able. We must be reminded that God has been faithful in the past, that he is good in the present, and will be with us in the future. Amen, church. Let's stand to our feet this morning.